The ASUS Duo 14 laptop has two screens. Yeah, whatever, I hear you say. They did that last year. Well, the new 11th gen model has some nice improvements that are worth discussing.
I've got the model with the Intel Xe graphics, but you can also get the Duo 14 with Nvidia MX 450 graphics if you need a bit more GPU horsepower. Plus, there's a larger 15-inch model with higher specs too. It's got a magnesium alloy blue-colored finish, and I thought the build quality felt good considering the thinner size and moving parts. Mine weighed around 1.6 kilos or 3.5 pounds, then a bit more with the small 65 watt Type-C charger included. As a small 14 inch machine, it's on the smaller side and around 1.7 centimeters thick, so fairly portable.
Let's start out with the dual screens, as this is the most unique feature of the Duo 14. We've got the main screen like normal, plus one down the bottom above the keyboard, which they refer to as the screen pad. Now, ASUS have done dual screen laptops in the past. However, the new 2021 models are the first time they've made the secondary screen rise up when you open the lid.
They did do this last year with the Zephyrus Duo 15 gaming laptop, so it's cool to see the idea move over to the ZenBook lineup too. Opening the lid raises the back of the machine up, giving the keyboard a slight incline for typing, and this also means the speakers aren't pressed directly against the table. I found it fine to use, but the back foot feels a bit different on my leg if I went to use it on my lap. There's more of a pressure point at the back rather than the usual flat surface. The main screen is a 14-inch 1080p panel, while the secondary screen is a 12.65-inch 1920 by 515 pixel screen, so slightly under half 1080p resolution vertically. Both are 60Hz touchscreens with a matte finish, so you can use either for drawing with the included stylus. Speaking of included, it also came with this case and a foldable stand in case you wanted even more elevation. The main screen offered much better color gamut than the secondary screen, so sticking to the main screen for content creation and using the secondary screen to display extra content seems to be the way to go. Both screens were able to surpass 300 nits. However, I found the screen pad was able to get brighter at maximum brightness. There were some bleed patches towards the upper corners with both screens, but it wasn't enough to notice during regular use outside of this worst case example. Basically, Windows just sees this as two separate monitors, so you can drag Windows over between the screens and set up whatever you like on the second screen, whether that be something like Discord chat or controls for an application. There are some good examples on the ASUS product page for the laptop that explain all of the functionality. Basically, we've got a bunch of shortcuts to quickly manage the secondary screen. We can adjust brightness, lock the keyboard so that it doesn't interfere with drawing, set shortcut apps to easily open, and more. The software also makes it easy to move windows between different screens, or set a window to take up both screens. There's also a dedicated button above the touchpad for swapping apps between screens, as well as a button that lets you turn the screen pad on or off. There are also some nice improvements for creative apps like Adobe Photoshop and Premiere. There's now more integration. With these apps open, we can use the provided control panel to create shortcuts on the touchscreen to speed up the workflow. A huge improvement. The 720p camera is above the display in the center, and it's got IR for Windows Hello support.
This is what the camera and microphone look and sound like, and this is what it sounds like to type on the keyboard. The keyboard and touchpad definitely take some getting used to. Typing with the chiclet keyboard isn't too bad as long as you've got enough space to push the laptop back far enough so that your hands sit in the right spot, as the front location of the keyboard means that it sits closer to you.
It's got white backlighting with three levels of key brightness, which lights up all keys and secondary functions. I thought typing felt fine. There's 1.4 millimeters of key travel. Here's how typing sounds to give you an idea of what to expect. Personally, I always found the precision touchpad awkward and small. It's just an unfortunate compromise to fit two screens in. I'd always prefer using a mouse whenever possible. There's not much area for fingerprints to show up on the interior, and you can only really see them on the touchscreens when it's off, as it's not a glossy finish. Otherwise, they appear easily on the lid and are a little challenging to clean with a microfiber cloth. On the left, there's a HDMI 1.4 output, two USB Type-C Thunderbolt 4 ports. Both of these can be used to charge the laptop, and both offer DisplayPort outputs. The right has a MicroSD card slot, 3.5mm audio combo jack, and a USB 3.2 Gen 1 Type-A port. The back just has some small rubber feet which come into contact with the desk when you open the lid. There's nothing over on the front. No groove for getting your finger in, but I didn't find it too hard to open. Opening it with one finger isn't possible due to the smaller size and lower weight. Lid flex is on the lower side due to the metal exterior, and the interior didn't have too much flex either, considering the laptop is on the thinner side. and that it's raised up off the desk. The screen pad just has hinges behind the corners holding it up, but even pushing harder than I ever normally would in the middle felt fairly sturdy, so nice build quality overall. There are no holes for air intake underneath, as air instead comes in below the screen pad. Getting inside requires taking out 9 TR5 screws, and the 4 down the front are shorter than the rest. The bottom panel was easy to pry off. Links to the tools I use can be found in the description. Once inside, we've got the battery down the front and single M.2 storage slot above towards the right. Memory is soldered to the motherboard, which is pretty typical for laptops at this size, but you can get it with up to 32 gig, so you'll have to buy with what you need from the start as you can't upgrade. We can also see where the MX450 GPU would be found if we had that, though I'm not sure if it would still be a single heatpipe. The speakers are towards the front on the left and right sides. I thought they sounded pretty good for a laptop of this size, definitely above average with some bass and loud enough at maximum volume. The latency mon results weren't too bad either. The Duo 14 is powered by a 4-cell 70 watt hour battery. I've run my usual YouTube playback test with keyboard lighting off and with both screens at 50% brightness. I also tested with the screen pad turned off to save battery, which gave it an extra 3 hours of runtime for over 10 hours in total. For the purposes of comparing with others though, I've chosen to use the runtime with both screens on, as that's likely how most people would use it. I figure if you're buying a dual screen laptop, you want to use two screens. The ASUS software also lets you select between different battery modes, which will keep the battery at different charge levels to prolong the lifespan of the battery. Let's check out thermals next. Air is pulled in behind the screen pad, and then exhausted out towards the main panel on the right. The MyASUS software lets you pick between three different performance modes, which from lowest to highest are Whisper, Balanced, and Performance, which ASUS say can sustain the full 28-watt TDP of the Intel i7-1165G7 processor. You can swap through software or with the function plus F shortcut combo anytime. The processor was cool at idle, and then with the Ada 64 CPU stress test running, it wasn't getting too hot, just a little over 70 degrees Celsius worst case in the highest performance mode, though I would expect warmer if you have the Nvidia MX450 graphics option and use that at the same time. These are the clock speeds from the same tests, so Whisper mode is a fair bit slower, which is why it was also running cooler. It's always a trade-off between performance and heat. These are the power levels that were being reached, so ASUS's claim of 28 watts in performance mode is indeed possible, which is good to see. Here's how CPU-only performance looks in Cinebench R20. Single-core performance isn't much different between balanced and performance, but the higher 28-watt power limit of performance mode allows for a 25% higher multi-core score. Here's how the best performance mode result compares against other laptops. So the single-core score is near those other 11th-gen laptops that I've tested, and although this is a quad-core processor, it's still offering one of the better multi-core scores for 4 cores. At idle, the keyboard was quite cool. The screen was a little warmer, but still cooler than most other laptops that I test, which are generally around the low 30 degrees Celsius point. It was just a bit warmer with the stress tests going in Whisper mode, mostly near the bottom of the lower screen. Balanced mode isn't too different, but the fans are louder now to compensate for the higher performance. Performance mode is again similar, and we can see the air exhausting onto the main screen on the right-hand side. Let's have a listen to the fan noise. It sounded completely silent to me at idle in Whisper mode. Even with the CPU stress test going, it was still extremely quiet. The fan is more audible in balanced mode, but still on the quieter side compared to most laptops I've tested. Then performance mode was a bit louder, though this is more of a worst case. You've got the option of running quieter if you're just browsing the internet, for example. Granted, a workload like that is nowhere near as hardcore as the stress test I'm testing with. Although not a gaming laptop by any means, the Intel Xe graphics are definitely capable of running games. AAA titles at 720p is possible as long as you're not going to max settings, while esports titles are fine even at 1080p. I've also tested some content creator workloads. Adobe Premiere video exporting doesn't do as well when compared to other laptops that have discrete AMD or Nvidia graphics though. When we look at the Puget Systems Premiere test, where higher scores are better now, it's a little more ahead as this tests for more things than just raw export times, such as live playback, but still similar to other Tiger Lake systems with Intel Xe graphics. Adobe Photoshop is heavily dependent on processor performance. And as we've seen before, the i7-1165G7 has excellent single-core performance in Cinebench. But I was still surprised to see such a high score here. DaVinci Resolve, on the other hand, is heavily dependent on the GPU, and the Intel Xe graphics just can't keep up compared to laptops with discrete GPUs. I've used Crystal Disk Mark to test the storage, and the 1TB NVMe M.2 SSD was doing very well, both for reads and writes. The MicroSD card slot, on the other hand, was on the lower side, even with a fast V90 card. The card clicks in and sits most of the way into the laptop. For updated pricing, check the links in the description, as prices will change over time. At the time of recording, the i5 configuration seems to start at $1,000 US, while the configuration I'm looking at is $1,300, and I'd expect the MX450 model to be higher. Overall, I think the idea of two screens in a laptop is definitely interesting, especially for content creator style workloads where you can actually benefit from more screen space. Personally, I think I would be more interested in the larger 15-inch model as it has higher tier specs. But for maximum portability, the smaller Duo 14 should have you covered. The improved software integration with Adobe applications was also great to see. It's always good to see unique designs like this that no one else is doing. And if you can live with the compromises something like this entails, mainly the keyboard down the front and that smaller touchpad, well, I can't see too much else to complain about. It's also hard to compare against other laptops out there, again due to this unique design. How would you use a dual screen laptop like this? Let me know down in the comments. And if you thought the video was useful, then throw a like on it. And of course, make sure you're subscribed for future laptop reviews like this one.